through that tiny, still voice, because he's God. Amen. Let's bow our heads in prayer. If there's any woman of God or any man of God around visiting, we welcome you all. You are wonderful people, and we love you. Amen.
Amen.
Let's bow our heads in prayer. Thank you, sweet Holy Spirit. There is nothing we can do without you. You are the source of our strength. You are the source of our lives. We live by your grace. We met death several times, but Lord, you spared us. We made mistakes many times, but you forgave us. Lord, we thank you for such a wonderful love. And Lord, we thank you for your power that breaks yokes and set the captives free. We honor thee. Our Father, we honor thee. We have no power of our own. We have no strength of our own. We depend and count on you, O God. We are human. We are just human. Without you, we'll fail. Thank you, Jesus. I'm only human. I'm just a human. Lord, teach me today what I have to and all I need to know. Show me the stairway that I have to climb. Lord, for my sake, teach me today what day. Lord, we bless and exalt your holy name for that which you alone is able to do. Thank you. Amen. Put your hands together for Jesus. Hallelujah. We thank God for all that the Lord is doing. He is simply God. And if he's in control, you can relax. If you have him in your life, you can relax. It doesn't matter how bad the wind will blow. It doesn't matter how terrible the storm will look like. You can just relax. If you have him in your boat, you can relax. But if you don't have him in your boat, then you are in trouble, because the storms will surely come. In the life of the believer, the storms of believers, the storm will come. Whatever you do, the storm will come. But in the life of the believer, he has Jesus in his boat. So when the storm comes, when the storm arises, he has somebody to call up to.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
And I want to tell you that the heart of the living God is for you, and it's 100%. He knows what he's doing in your lives, and he knows what you're going through. Amen. He knows you by your name and by your address. Amen. And if he has spoken, then he will surely do it.
Amen.
He said, have I not said it? And will I not do it? I thank God for the theme of this fire conference: the yoke breaker. Yesterday we spoke about the yoke. We read something from Exodus chapter 6 verse 6. And we read something from Isaiah chapter 10 verse 27, which is our main message for the program. So I want to read the Isaiah chapter 10, verse 27 again. Amen.
Amen.
Minister Sampong, can you read it for us? But this time from New King James Version. Okay, I have the New King James here, never mind.
Yeah, King James.
Isaiah chapter 10, verse 27. This is what the Lord says. Let me continue.
Yes,
thank you. It shall come to pass in that day, that is today, that his bare shoulder and his yoke from your neck, and the yoke be destroyed because of the anointed oil. Hallelujah.
Amen. Amen.
Yesterday we made an illustration with how fathers used to work. And a certain part of the world, they still do the same thing, where they'll get an oxen, a cow, or any animal that is strong, and they will place a wooden, heavy wooden thing at the neck for the animal to work for the person. And we learn that if the animal has the yoke, the animal doesn't have any choice again than to follow the instructions given to it by the owner of the yoke. And when the animal is not used to carrying the yoke, the animal has to be trained in carrying the yoke. During the training, the animal will receive some whips and will be forced until it is conformed to what the yoke owner wants the animal to do. One of the animals that is a bit difficult to handle is a cow. Cow is very strong. You can get the cow to do everything that you want, but they easily want to, or they quickly want to seek for means of stopping work. So to train a cow, for the cow to work for you effectively, you must be skillful in training the cow how the cow has to move with the yoke.
Amen.
And I said something that many of you here, the issues that you've been experiencing in your life may have much to do with the yoke of the enemy. Well, the Bible makes us to understand that the yoke is not your yoke, it is the enemy's yoke. But because you are carrying it, because you feel that yoke, that is your thing. It isn't yours. Because the Bible says that his yoke shall be destroyed. Not your yoke. You don't have any yoke. So the cancer you may be carrying in your body is not yours. But because you are carrying in your body, you call it my sickness. But you are only a carrier of somebody's sickness. Hallelujah.
Amen.
If the enemy knows that if he succeeds in placing cancer in your body, for all the days of your life, you're going to be in pain, agony, in mess, in misery, and you die before the time the Lord has prepared for you. Why must he do that? The enemy takes pleasure seeing you suffer. Satan hates you. Witches hate you. Evil spirit hates you. Somebody may be possessed by a demon, and demon sometimes may be helping you. But I want to tell you that the demon is only using you. His idea of taking refuge in you is to steal your joy, to kill you and to destroy you, and to make sure that you miss heaven. The enemy knows that Jesus loves you so much, and he hates that. So he has to bring a yoke on you. And when somebody walks with a yoke for a long time, even when the yoke is broken, the person still remains in bondage. And this is what I want to throw light on.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Learning a new walk and learning a new talk. If somebody is used to carrying a yoke for a long time, the person's system, the way he moves, the way he thinks, the way he reasons, is controlled by the yoke. And when the yoke is broken, that person sometimes, or most of the time, thinks he's still under the bondage. And that is very, very painful. There's a story that I love to tell so much whenever I have the opportunity. A little boy about 8 years went with his daddy to a circus. And the boy saw a huge elephant, strong elephant, that could destroy the whole place, tied with a little rope, a tiny rope. And asked the daddy, "Daddy, you've told me that elephant is strong. And I can see how huge, how gigantic this animal is. How come have they succeeded in tying this animal with just a tiny rope?" That's an intelligent question for a little boy to ask. And this is what the enemy has done in the lives of many of you. And the father told the boy that, "Boy, when this elephant was little, they used metal chain to tie the elephant. The elephant stayed in the chain for a long time, until it grew and lost control and lost confidence in its strength. And when the elephant has lost the strength or the belief in itself, you don't even need to tie the elephant again. It will not move anywhere." Yeah. If Jesus breaks the yoke, somebody got to learn a new walk.
Amen.
Somebody got to learn a new talk. Somebody got to learn to understand a new command. Amen. You can put your hands together for Jesus, because I believe the hand that you have is yours. Hallelujah. This is where many believers have got into. And they try, and it looks like they don't see the glory of God. So they turn back to their old state, because now that Jesus cannot help us. When Jesus breaks the yoke out of your life, this is what he does. When minister, please come around. Amen.
Amen.
And evangelist, please come around. You are Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
We don't have a Satan here,
yeah,
but we're going to do. I'm going to tell you how he does his things. Yeah. You are Jesus, and you are going to, you know, welcome him. Help him gradually that he will learn to walk on his own, you see? Right. So, Jesus will be, you know, you'll just be giving him a sign, but you don't hold his hand yet, because he got to learn how to walk before you hold his hand. Great. So you're going to show him gradually, and when he's coming, you just go back so that he will have more opportunity to exercise how to walk.
Amen. Amen.
Right. So when the yoke is broken, so you move forward towards Jesus gradually. The yoke is broken. Satan cannot stand between the two of them.
Yeah.
So what he does is that he hangs around you whilst you are going to Jesus. And he'll be whispering things in your ears. And he'll be telling you things. And he'll be telling you things. And he'll be telling you things. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
Amen. Put your hands together for him. When the yoke is broken, the person is set free. But the person got to learn that he is free. And this is what many believers are missing. The man that broke the yoke doesn't leave you there. Jesus will not pass you by. He will not just break the yoke and leave you there and walk away. You are so precious to him. That is why he came to die for you. And when he breaks your yoke, he knows that he can do something good with your life. He's going to receive some glory with your life. So he begins to teach you how to walk, son. He tells you how to walk, daughter. Make one step more. Come, boy. Come, boy. Hallelujah.
Amen.
He will not break the yoke and leave you behind and walk away because he doesn't care. And neither will he break the yoke and carry you. No. He got to train you how to walk, because the enemy that placed the yoke on your neck, you are going to be on your toe, and you are going to be on fire, and you are going to destroy his kingdom. He knows you can destroy his kingdom. That is why he placed yoke on your life. And Jesus got to teach you how to walk, how to run, how to jump, how to speak in tongues, how to die in the things of God. So there's a process. The yoke is broken, but he needs time to work it out. Say, Lord, work me out. Until he finishes working out, he's not going to use you because you're too immature. Until he finishes working you out, he's not going to bring that gentleman because you're too rough. You speak anyhow to men. You treat women anyhow. You don't care. You slap, you fight, you beat women. Until Jesus works it out with you, he's not bringing that precious, the favor of God is upon a man. It doesn't take a person to struggle to succeed in life. You will not struggle to succeed in life. You will not struggle to succeed in life. It doesn't struggle to succeed in life. It is the favor of God that makes a person rich, and he doesn't add any sorrow to it. And I preach it to somebody. Hallelujah. But he got to after the yoke of poverty is broken. To learn a new habit, because the yoke is broken, but you are still hooked to an old habit, old spending habit. Any money that falls into your head, you gotta buy a new shoe, you gotta buy a new jacket, you gotta buy this, you gotta buy that. It is bad. There's nothing wrong buying new things when you have, but if you don't have, and any little thing that you have, you must spend it, then you gotta change that spending habit. Because when the spirit or the yoke of poverty is placed on a person, the yoke of poverty, make sure the demons controlling that yoke, make sure that money doesn't come into your hands, or even if money comes into your hands, it doesn't stay, so that you remain poor. Hallelujah.
Amen.
And if the yoke of sickness is placed upon somebody, sometimes demons will cause you to develop wrong eating habit and wrong diet. So when Jesus heals you from that sickness, you got to train yourself and change your eating habit. You don't eat fufu at 2 a.m. You don't eat eba at 3 a.m. No! Put your hands together with Jesus. And somebody will tell me that, Bishop, I'm hungry. What must I do? Yes, you got to eat something. But at that time, good for your health. You can drink something, a juice. You can drink tea, the warm, before you go to sleep. Because the body that the Lord has given to you, you shall give account of it one day. Hallelujah. This body was borrowed to you because you, in the first place, you are not a body. You are a spirit. You have a soul, and you live in that body. So you are a spirit being given a body so that you can be legal on this planet. So that body has been borrowed to you, and you don't misuse it. If you misuse it, you die early. If you misuse your body, you die early. Go about sleep with any woman and you die early. Go about sleep with any man and die early, because you're abusing the body that is supposed to be the temple of the living God. Why must you live long? What is the essence of you living long? What are you contributing to the body? What are you contributing to the church? What are you contributing to the body of Christ? Hallelujah. Somebody, when you are sick on your dying bed, never think that you're going to die, because you got to live for the Lord. And to contribute to the work of the living God. Satan must take his yoke away, because that yoke is destroyed already. Can I hear amen?
Amen.
When you're talking about a body, many of us don't do exercise at all. Oh, come on, tell me. When was the last time you went to gym? Gym? With a mouth. Put your hands together for Jesus. At least I have somebody who agree with me. Gym with a man. Hallelujah. But the thing is, when that yoke is broken, you got to be ready to put your shape together, put your body together. together. Fix yourself together. If I tell you that you have to bend and jump and bend and jump and come green for 10 times, you will need to call the ambulance. There are certain sicknesses that the Holy Spirit or God or the anointing will not even heal. No. There are certain sicknesses the anointing of God will not heal you. Why? Because maybe Satan didn't bring that sickness. You brought it to yourself. Just trust yourself. And you do too. Hallelujah.
Amen.
When the yoke is broken, you got to learn to do certain things. When the yoke is broken, you got to learn to do certain things. I was thinking about if there were to somebody maybe working at the Sparkasse or any of the banks in this ministry.